Mr. Frank Anthony, the founder of the school and chairman of the governing body, MP, is taking the salute. The school captain, Samir Pambani, the banner, Mr. Anthony's personal motto, courage is destiny.
We were regarded as the pillars of British imperialism, brought deliberately into existence by the British to serve their imperial interests, which we did. And that made us the best hated political community in the country. Normally, we should have been chased out of India with the British. But I put it down to my leadership that I was able to get the leaders of India to accept us. Not only accept us, but give us a special position in the Indian Constitution. We had made a contribution out of all proportion to our size. We had the largest network of railway lines in the world. We had one of the finest custom services in the world. These had been built by this microscopic minority. India's greatest national assets had been built by us.
The Anglo-Indian community can trace its roots back to the 17th century. The term Anglo-Indian is used to describe the community in India of mixed European and Indian descent, the European element being on the male side.
And we were not just a half-caste community born outside of wedlock. The British wanted people whom they could rely on. So they subsidized the marriages of their soldiers and their officers with Indian women.
In 1638, the directors of the East India Company, inspired for the first time by visions of empire, initiated a policy deliberately aimed at encouraging mixed unions. The marriage of our soldiers to the native women of Fort St. George in Madras is a matter of such consequence to posterity that we shall be content to support it at some expense, around 8 to 9 shillings, if this small encouragement will increase the number of such marriages.
That is how we came in, because of the subsidized marriages. And then you got a community whom the British relied on very heavily for well over 100 years in order to support their growing empire.
How were Anglo-Indians treated by the British in the early days?
Completely as equals for over 100 years. At about 1800, globe-trotting ignoramus, Lord Valentia, was sent out. And he saw a community, at that time we were wealthy and largely in the armed forces. And at that time, what Haiti had to do with us, I don't know, he had nothing to do with it, but the people of mixed blood there had joined with the locals to drive the Spanish out. So he said, here's a community, they haven't the sloth of the Hindus or of the Muslims. They're highly respected, well-placed. They can easily lead the people of the country to drive the British out, as it happened in Haiti. And then the British, as a matter of policy, suddenly decided to throw the Anglo-Indians out en bloc from the British army. And for thousands of Anglo-Indians, that was their only occupation. Soldiering was what their fathers were soldiers, their grandfathers were soldiers. So they offered their swords to the Indian princes. India at that time had not been taken over completely by the British. They had numerous princes, varying degrees of power.
One of the Anglo-Indians who offered his sword to the Indian princes was James Skinner, who later founded the celebrated regiment known as Skinner's Horse. Today, the regiment is firmly established as one of the premier armored corps in the Indian Army. A former commandant of Skinner's horse is Colonel Mike Skinner, the great-great-grandson of James Skinner.
Gentlemen, let's drink to the regiment.
James Skinner was one of six children born to a Scottish officer of the East India Company. His mother was the daughter of a Rajput landowner. He had always wanted to follow his father and join the company army.
Well, due to his mixed descent, it was impossible for him to get service with the British army, because there was a decree passed in May 1792 which debarred offsprings of Indians from getting employment in the civil, military, or the marine services.
So at the age of 17, Skinner joined Scindia, one of the most powerful of the Marhatta princes, whose territory covered at its height most of Hindustan. He quickly made a name for himself in battles between the rival princes, and his regiment later became known as the Yellow Boys because of their distinctive uniform.
He could inspire them and talk to them, and in the very beginning, you see, he wielded them into a unit, a cooperative unit, something that was never seen in the armies at that time. Time and again, they displayed their skill riding at speed. He taught these people the tent pegging, where peg was driven into the ground and people rode at it at speed and picked it up. He was affectionately given the title of Sikanda Sahab. Sikanda is the Indian equivalent to Alexander. He was likened to Alexander the Great.
The British had not yet taken control of northern India, but slowly they advanced into Marhatta territory and declared war in 1803. The Marhattas reacted by dismissing their Anglo-Indian officers, whom they suddenly accused of being kith and kin to the British. Lord Lake, commander-in-chief of the British forces, was well aware of Skinner's reputation and wanted to use his local knowledge and expertise. But because of the decree barring Anglo-Indians, he could only offer Skinner and his men work as irregular cavalry. Captain Skinner reluctantly accepted and went on to distinguish himself in battle after battle as the British overran India. Despite this, he remained technically an irregular officer. The coveted King's commission, without which he could not gain superior rank, was still denied him.
He had hoped that with his services under the British, that the various prejudices and this decree that went out in 1792, that would be reversed. But he was mistaken. His mixed birth neither made him one or the other, and they couldn't make up their minds whether people like Skinner could be treated as Indians or as British subjects.
It took a threat of resignation before the British government finally relented, and in 1826 he was awarded the double honour of a King's Commission and the Companion of the Bath. But this wasn't his final achievement.
Moses warns Israel against...
It was at this battle where he's lying wounded, mortally wounded, that he makes this vow that if God spared his life, he would build a church. He fulfills his vow and he builds the church at Kashmiri Gate, known as St. James's Church to this day.
This is the word of the Lord.
Towards the end, he became very religious, and he considered himself a great sinner, and he said, well, I want everyone who enters the church to trample over my grave. Well, he wasn't actually buried at the entrance of the church. He's buried at the what was then the altar. And there he lies buried to this day. And so his wish, in a way, was fulfilled.
Regiments like Skinner's Horse, raised by Anglo-Indians, helped the British to take control of India. The Mutiny of 1857, nowadays better known as India's First War of Independence, proved to be the next major turning point for the Anglo-Indian community. Their loyalty to the British in quelling the uprising was unquestionable. But Anglo-Indians still had a curious relationship with their masters.
It was, in a sense, a split psychology. When the national anthem, the British national anthem was played, the Anglo-Indians used to stand very much to attention. But there was also this resentment of their being badly treated by the British. But we played a not negligible role during the mutiny. And wherever there were uprisings, British were slaughtered. And when the Anglo-Indians were available, they were equally slaughtered. So that, in a way, would have impelled the Anglo-Indians, and there were natural ties of blood. And they had to choose what to do, they went out of their way to help the British. And there are many stories of heroism of young Anglo-Indians. After the mutiny, the British suffered some pangs of conscience. They said, let us make some measure of requital to these people. So they then began to recruit us en masse into what became the key services of India. We built India's national assets, railways, telegraphs, customs. We built them. No other community would go into the jungles at that time. We had to penetrate the jungles. Anglo-Indians seldom saw their families for 5 and 7 years. All the middle or upper middle jobs were reserved for Anglo-Indians. There were not so much reservations as monopolies of jobs. Any Anglo-Indian, educated or uneducated, could just go and offer himself and get a job. Not too much of a job, but as a guard or a driver or a fireman on the railways, the police, and so forth. But they would never allow us to get beyond a certain position.
Well, in the days in the 19th century, the Anglo-Indians were having the English blood in them, the forefathers' blood. So they were stout-hearted, and they were able to get into the local running side, where they were able to man the steam engines. Because the steam engines at that time, it was hard work, which needed a lot of robust physic and a quality of courage. So most of the Anglo-Indians were co-opted into the local running staff. And we kept it alive, and it was a pride for us to bring in our engine in the clean and polished way. Hence, that was our motto, to keep alive the Anglo-Indians where we were stabled at India, keeping the good name of our forefathers.
We were a crowd that, you know, were able to master the railways, you know, in driving and firing and things like that, compared to the others. Of course, it was tough, because we had to run a good speed those days on steam locos. It was not very easy, shoveling about 10 tons of coal for a night, starting at 9 in the night and breaking up next morning at 6, 7. And each driver and crew had a permanent loco, and we had them nicely maintained. And it was a pride, one crew trying to outbeat the other crew, you know, in the performance of these locos, because we were getting punctuality awards. Even run late, we were able to make the time up on these permanent locos.
Anglo-Indians played the role of buffer between the British and the Indians. They were a very small community, but a very loyal community. The British thought, well, it's good to have somebody between us and the large mass of people who carry out dharnas and obstruct traffic and do things like that. So they recruited them in the police force, which was then very vital. In the customs, also very vital because of honesty. And railways. Railways had to run on time, carrying merchandise from A to B, C to D. Meant money, loss of time. Trains running late meant loss of economy, bad economy, and loss of money. So this is how they encouraged this community
to develop on certain lines, but this meant keeping them very much in a closed jacket, if I may say so, in a vacuum. And there they grew in that vacuum and, of course, imitated the masters. If it was a club for the British, it was a railway institute for the Anglo-Indians. And so it went on, dances and misdrives and talking of home, sort of Kent cantonment, and expressions like this used to come up, you see. Where are you from? Oh, I'm from Sussex cantonment, you know. This has also happened in this country at certain levels. So I think this was the big delusion. They had champagne tastes with beer incomes. Now, I don't know whether they can afford beer today, but anyway, in my time, they like to have a good time.
A comfortable existence it may have been, but the British days were fast coming to a close, and the community's very survival in India was soon to be challenged. And then, a young up-and-coming lawyer came onto the scene.
I am the president and chief of the All India Anglo-Indian Association. We celebrated our centenary in October 1976. You see, the community also, like every community, had its tendencies to divisiveness. And in the different states, they had little organizations, each one more impotent than the other from the political point of view. The first person of any All India stature to come on the scene was my predecessor, Colonel Sir Henry Gidney, person of international repute as an eye surgeon, and as I said in my book, a connoisseur art collector with a connoisseur's eye for beautiful women. And he united the community. He was able to get all these disparate and ineffective provincial organizations under one banner. We were the best hated community in India politically when I took over from Sir Henry Gidney after I was elected.
As Lord Mountbatten said, with the departure of the British forces, the outward and visible sign of British rule in India disappears, and its place is taken by something much more valuable, a really great friendship between the British and the Indians.
British went out. They gave us several kicks in our political pants. I appeared before the cabinet mission. Unfortunately, I say that deliberately, the Labour Party was in power. And more unfortunately, you had an able but rigidly oriented lawyer, Cripps, as the chairman. And when I put the case of the community, he was ignorant of our history. He started dealing in statistics. He said, but you're only at most 200,000 people. How can I give you any representation in the Constituent Assembly? We are formulating it on the basis, more or less, of one seat to a million people. How can we give you 500% weightage? So he wouldn't even give me one seat. I said, let me have one seat so that I can state my special case, my needs, my history to the framers of the Constitution. He refused. Then I went to the UK. I met the British cabinet there, Attlee and these people. Nothing happened. Churchill did his best to help. They raised, the members of the Conservative Party raised this, but nothing happened.
I told my colleagues, I said, well, this is the end of the community.
Fortunately, I had been elected in 42. All this began to break in about 45. And I had basically changed the policy of the community, which was a claim by Gandhi, Nehru, and Sardar Patel. And briefly, what I said was this, that we are Anglo-Indians. We have a proud history of which any much larger community could be justifiably proud. But let us always remember that we have an Indian birthright, that we are Indians by nationality, we're Anglo-Indians by community. And to the leaders of India, they thought that was a revolution in our thinking. The first year after I was elected, the MLA from the Punjab moved a vote of no confidence against me for postulating that we are Indians. He didn't want the community to be referred to as Indians. So when the British let me down, I met Gandhi, I met Nehru, I met Sardar Patel. I met Gandhi first. He said, we have been in jail, but we've been following your other thing. And how many seats do you want? Being a lawyer, I pitched my demands at a ceiling limit. I said, Gandhiji, give me 3 seats. And good old man that he was, he said, I will back you for 3 seats. And the net result was, after tremendous opposition from some people who had not forgotten the fact that we had been the standard bearers of British imperialism in India, tremendous opposition, several members of the ruling Congress opposed giving us anything. Ultimately, I was able to get special representation, which we still have in Parliament, state legislatures. I got special quotas in the services, continuance in railways, telegraphs, customs. I got the continuance of our special educational grants. But most of those wasted out after 10 years. The others have continued.
I walked along the heavily carpeted passages to the room which had been Gandhiji's. He was shrouded in spotless white khadi. His chest was bare. And I could see the dark patches of the assassin's bullets against the skin of his frail body.
The historic 7.5-hour radio commentary on the funeral of Mahatma Gandhi in 1948 placed Melville de Mello in the Guinness Book of Records. Today, he's India's leading broadcaster and is himself an Anglo-Indian.
I was born a British subject by birth in an Indian state. And when India became free, apart from one sister who was married to a rear admiral in the army, in the Navy, who settled in this country, I was the only member of the family that stayed on. Books have been written about staying on now, but anyway, I'm not part of that saga. I stayed on because I thought this was the place of my birth, and a lot had washed off on me in this country. And my passport then was changed to citizen of India. And I decided when I saw that passport that I should make every effort to join the mainstream of Indian life. The whole of India is my community. And I don't draw any distinctions between Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, or Christian. To me, they're all human beings.
In your opinion, why did so many members of your community emigrate?
That's very simple. The Britishers, who were then a top layer, and I'm talking now of my own state, Jodhpur, and my own brothers and sisters, sounded an alarm, if I may put it that way, that we're off, and the best thing you can do is to get the other end as well, because you're going to be in trouble. And many people took that very seriously, did not want to give the Indian government a chance, or the new leaders a chance, and they fled. Some was due to religious reasons, others could not visualize their daughters marrying good-looking sardars or good-looking Hindus, and so they left. They thought their way of life had come to an end, and the only way they could pick it up again was by getting the other side. India has progressed tremendously in all fields, and it is no longer the backward country that most people thought it was and used to be once upon a time. But you have to have the human material to take advantage of the opportunities that are available in this country today. And vis-a-vis the community, I don't see many of that community coming up to grasp these many opportunities to either better themselves or get into the mainstream of Indian life and progress.
Mm-hmm.
Bangalore, the modern capital of the state of Karnataka, is a thriving industrial and commercial center. Because of its temperate climate, it was once a summer resort of the Raj. The city is studded with parks and gardens that still echo its colonial past. Not far away, on the rural outskirts, is Whitefield, a suburb where today many successful Anglo-Indians who chose to stay in India after independence have formed a retirement colony.
First Anglo-Indian came here in 1902. They were a family from the Nilgiri Hills who migrated down here and bought, I think, 100 acres of land. And they started the first settlers' union in Whitefield. Then, this brought us to about the 30s. The war came, many of the young people moved out, joined the forces, and after the war, a lot of people left Whitefield to migrate to England and Australia. Community dropped in numbers. Then you come to 15 years ago when people were retiring from government service, from business, and Whitefield offered the only possible area where Anglo-Indians lived, where land was reasonably cheap. And at this point of time, you now have about 100 families living here.
And me too, and me too.
Never mind him.
Hang on, let me.
A little bit of food, please, Mr. Fermi. You're on diet.
Ned, sling some on there for me, please. Just the soup's on.
I feel we've lost the best of the community. They went very young. Their parents were originally disenchanted with India. They felt that there would be some sort of reprisal on the community for the support it gave to the British when they were here. Largely, this has not been borne out.
Anyone else raising?
I had a very good education. I got into the army. There I found no prejudices at all against the Anglo-Indian. In fact, they leaned over backwards because we couldn't form cliques. We were too small a community. I therefore found that we were well-liked and most of us rose very high in rank.
Jenny, what is your feeling about having stayed on?
Well, I didn't have a choice because I married very young and the rest of the family went. My only sister, only brother, aunts, uncles, cousins, everybody. But because I was married to Donald, he was in the forces, I stayed.
Did you ever consider emigrating, either of you?
No.
No. I would say I gave it great thought, but decided against it because of economic problems. I wasn't able to get my money across due to government regulations, and I'd much rather enjoy it over here.
Apart from not having my family, if you gave me a Marks, a Sainsbury's and a Boots, I wouldn't have to leave.
Yes, after 40 years.
Yes,
yes. Is it
first
time
after 40 years?
I find a great change, you know.
Otherwise, there it will be about 500.
She would have gone to school today.
The time for emigration, as far as I was concerned, would have been when I was debobbed from the army in 1945. Just at that time, I had already tried for and had been selected for the Indian Revenue Service. So when the exodus from India took place, I was well settled here. And there was no point in burning my boats here and to go to some place and starting off afresh.
One of my friends is 82, and she could outdance any young girl, 50 years younger. A little more quiet here. But you know...
No, you've had some damn good shows over here.
Yes.
The older group, the ones that held some sort of positions in India, they must have found it very difficult in England. You know, the ego problems of having to accept jobs of a lesser status. Some of those have come back to India. Only recently, a senior lieutenant colonel of the army has returned from Australia. But the younger group have found the opportunities far more there and have settled down beautifully abroad.
Well, we've got a daughter of 24 and three boys of 22, 21 and 19. All of whom are in three boys are in college. And I think I'd like them to go abroad and do further training. Also see what it's like and then make their own decisions.
Do you have aspirations for them getting good jobs abroad or here?
Here. But then with a foreign degree, a British degree, for instance, they'd go that much further.
Who's going to attack it first? Come on.
I do have two children. My son is in America. He's a doctor, married a girl from our own community, and they emigrated about 10 years ago. Then I have a daughter, Margaret, currently with us in India, but I think the little bird's going to fly.
Well, I'm going to England, really. My husband and I have decided to move for the sake of our son, because the opportunities here are not as good as they would be for him there. I'll miss my parents, but I think it would be a better move if we left.
We'll miss her, but we can't stop them. Paul and Margaret have got to make their own lives.
The writing is on the wall. The community is endogamous. There is virtually no new blood coming in to create new units of the community. And personally, I feel, with nature being what it is, I would give this community 40 to 50 years more before it either has to disappear or get absorbed into the greater Indian mass.
Out of the approximately 4.5 lakhs, which is 450,000 Anglo-Indians all over India, the largest concentration of Anglo-Indians was in West Bengal, and the largest in West Bengal was in Calcutta. Even today, out of the 120,000 Anglo-Indians at a minimum all over India, 20,000 live in Calcutta alone, concentrated in such areas as Ripon Street, Elliot Road, Kidapur in the south. In the whole of West Bengal, we have 4 million people unemployed. And the Anglo-Indian community, being microscopic and not equipped as it should be, will naturally feel the pinch of unemployment much more. I think that in Calcutta and around the country, the major ailment, if that is the correct word, which the community has, is that there is a lack of a sense of belonging, a lack of roots. And so, not only in the early years after independence, but even today, in almost every home, people are thinking of emigration.
Our type of living is very different. We live actually for the day. We are not that type to live for the future. You know, whatever we earn, we sort of spend it in a day. We can't think of, you know, tomorrow and the after and the day after. It's like we feel like whatever we want to eat and how we want to, you know, see movies and everything, we just, you know, have it for that day. And people can't adapt their way like how we live. They see us as a very, like, aliens, you know, and living in there, in this country, especially in India, you know, they think us to be a very low type of people.
And what do they think
community.
About women, though?
Normally they look down on the Anglo-Indian women because of the carefree life that we live, you know.
Like, we don't live on the opinion of others. We normally do things to please ourselves. So according to them, they feel that the women really aren't good. But our society usually doesn't care much about their opinions anyway.
I feel we live for the day. We earn something today, we enjoy today. We don't think about what's going to happen 10 years from now, tomorrow, the after. We're happy with ourselves and within our community.
As a matter of fact, there's a spiritual song only that it says that, Lord, for today, for tomorrow, and its means I do not pray. Just keep me alive for today. So we live according to the Bible, like, you know.
When I became a nun, I didn't realize that the Anglo-Indians were not really welcome people, that they had some kind of slur on them. Because before that, I thought I was an Indian. It's only when I was a nun, you know, that I became aware that I was an Anglo-Indian. I mean, I didn't make much of my exterior, but the nuns made much of me, and they made me aware that I was an Anglo-Indian. I just started my teaching career. That's the time I came in contact with the Anglo-Indian community of the railway colonies. And when I saw the difference in the way I was brought up and the way they lived, I sort of got a cultural shock, actually. And that was the time that I became more aware of the community's problems and their poverty and all that. Now, most of these families are broken homes. Now, they're broken, I don't know why, because maybe they are poor people, that's why. Or maybe this poverty is because they're not educated, and therefore they've got no jobs. Or they don't fit into the society in which they are. So there are so many angles to this misery that these people are in, so I really can't pinpoint what exactly is a problem of the community. Hello. I think there's a lot of indifference, there's no motivation, you know, they only want to have a good time. And those of them who have really no zest for life and no hope for the future, they depend a lot on charities for their meals and for their clothes. And therefore they just vegetate or exist for the sake of existing, they don't really live. And our Indian people, they don't mind working in gutters or in dumping grounds and, you know, trying to make a living out of all that. But our Anglo-Indians, they want to get the easiest way out. Like, they know that Mother Teresa gives them a lot of food and, you know, clothes, and all the institutions are there to help them. So they won't do the degrading work that the Indians do. So they just relax the whole day. And then when they feel hungry, they know where to get their food. And they go to those places and they get it. That's all.
I don't think we ever relaxed out here. It's all tough going, you know.
Well, as far as I am concerned, there's no problems for me. It's okay. As long as if you can have a good job here, and I mean, if you work regularly, there's no problem. Because India is a good country.
I feel India, you know, being an Anglo-Indian, you really don't get a job. The moment you tell them your good name, you know, and they get your title there, an Anglo-Indian, they tell you, we'll let you know. That let you know means you'll never see that office again, like. And somehow we managed by guys bringing foreign stuff down, you know, we sell it for them, make a 500 bucks or 200-300 on each article. And that's how I think I'm all right.
Sometimes the husband just proves, you know, good initially, which normally happens, like. Later on when they find that things are going smooth and they have a tendency to sit back and say, okay, fine, the money is coming in. Then they start leaving jobs, they start taking to some drugs or something like that. And then eventually, you know, it becomes a regular affair.
What are their problems?
The problem is that they are too lazy to even go out and look for a job. And so that it comes to that they don't get a chance.
Very few get a chance. Before it was through sports, Anglo-Indians were the best, you know. But now
we can prove it.
We can still do a lot, you know. And in through sports you get jobs these days. And
I mean, given the right chance, you can beat the guys out here. The real Indians. If we guys given the real opportunity, I think we can beat them any day.
We can do a lot of things.
We can do it better than them.
But it just depends on opportunities, you know.
They depend wholly and solely on the wife to earn and bring the money home. They don't really care whether you have your money for the next day or not. As long as you give that money for them to have their drinks and drugs, they are happy. But it's the women that's slog. It's mostly the women. I think about 90% of the Anglo-Indian women are working. There are, I won't say no, there are Anglo-Indian boys that do work, but you can say 80 or 90% are the useless, who don't want to work.
I have a lot of problems by getting a job. And my friends help me out. And I've got a big family, and in one small little room, we all go together, about 12 of us, in a very small room. So I just lie back and go to sleep. That I don't know the world. I don't know you, and I don't know anyone. When I have dopes, or if I have drink, I just go home, relax, and go to sleep. That's all.
I've never taken it. I don't really like anybody that takes drugs too. But drinks, yeah, I do drink occasionally. That even I'm not habituated.
I take drugs. I don't like drink. As a matter of fact, I'm hooked on to a certain drug which is derived from poppy. Most of the drugs now are derived from poppy, and I'm on a drug called smack. I don't know what they call it out there in England, but here we call it smack.
It's heroin.
It's not a very pure form of heroin, it's a very poor quality of heroin. And normally after I come back from work, I hooked on that, so I smoke it.
If whether he drinks or he takes brown, I'm not frightened like that, because he's not a, what should I say, he's not a boisterous man. He loves me, and I try to make him give this up, but I'm trying still hard. It's quite deep now, but I hope I can make him give it up. But like that way, I'm not frightened that he's drunk, or I'm the one that keeps nagging, because I don't like it.
Why do you stick it out?
I stick it out because I love him, and I married him because I loved him.
It doesn't give me any really mental pleasure, sort of a thing. But it's just because I'm hooked onto it, I smoke it like a cigarette. So after I come back from work, I normally smoke that. It gives me a little bit of a high, and I feel okay.
My husband used to drink. He was a very great drinker before. He used to hammer me. I had to run away from the house through fear, because I had a baby. But of course, of late, he has learned a lesson, and he has given it up. But you see, these are the downfalls when they drink. Marriages do break up through this drinking.
What happens is actually the husband's, at least my husband has been drinking for a very long time and beats me up badly. That is there. And that's what happens is, like, you know, we start losing faith in them.
It's been real tiring today. Fix the drink here, at least. Please.
Personally, I don't want to leave my husband only for the sake of my children. It's because, you know, practically all marriages in Anglo-Indian community are breaking up. And the children are growing up very differently. They are, you know, just being led astray. The children are growing, they don't go to school because the parents don't bother about it, and they are going on drugs and things like that. But if every Anglo-Indian woman, I mean, especially our community, if we just pull ourselves together, we can keep our homes going even with a drunkard husband because of our children.
Now, if I didn't start this nursery, most of these kids wouldn't be in school. I somehow picked them up from very broken social environments, broken homes, economically poor homes, etc. I picked up those kids from there because I feel that these kids need very special handling.
Good morning, children.
Good morning, ma'am.
What do you want to play with? What do you all want to play with this morning, children?
Good?
Yes? And you will play nicely?
Yeah.
Okay. No throwing it out?
Yeah.
Okay? Yes, then you'll get the ball.
I aim to bring these kids up to a certain level in education, so that when I put them into regular school, I want these kids to be really up to the mark. And I also feel that my kids are very emotionally deprived children. So it's not just learning A, B, C, D and, you know, the three R's as such, but to give them a lot of affection and love and to sort of boost that ego in them, which is already deflated as little babies that they are.
Come. Beauty, you want a ball, Beauty? Okay, Beauty, here.
Mom, what's this? Mama, please.
The mothers in the beginning, they never bothered about their kids, the attendance in school and all that. But now, since they've seen the children progressing, even the discipline has improved a lot. So the mothers do feel that we are doing a good job in the nursery. So they too are interested. And the mothers do come to me, like, you know, to discuss their problems. As soon as they bring their children, they take time off and they talk to me.
What have you got for me?
Apple. How did you hurt your nose? You fell down. How did you fall down? And now we're going to play with the ball, you're going to fall down again. Yes.
Has anybody thought about emigrating? Are you happy here?
That's right, we want to. We have relations also. But they said it's quite tough. I mean, even if we can't go, if our children get a chance, that also we'll be very grateful for. But they also don't get a chance.
I don't think we'd be much happier anywhere else like we are here in this country.
I don't get the feeling you're that happy with all the experiences.
Of course, because basically we have a very relaxed life out here. Their life is going to be very mechanical and things, you know, you've got to really follow a system. And the time you get here, the leisurely time you get, you will not get it anywhere else. Although for the sake of the children's future, okay, we might consider that fact. But I don't think there's any place better than India out here. And life over there is even faster still. Their marriages break up even faster than you expect. Here, at least somehow with all the problems and poverty, you stick.
There's no future, there is no life for Anglo-Indians in India. Especially, you see, abroad, you have to work. You can't sit at home, otherwise you're back to India. But like this in India, they just take it cool. I mean, they don't want to work, so they just stay back and they... But abroad, you can't do that. And then, you see, the salaries we are getting here is nothing. What we earn in a month, abroad, the people are getting it within 3 days, 4 days. So that way we are very, very bad, in a very bad position in India. So we would love to go abroad.
I think our leaders should impress upon the government that this wonderful community, a mix between the past and the present rulers, must be given preferential treatment. Otherwise there is no hope of getting them out off the bottom of the barrel. The government has this program where backward class people get preferential treatment of some degree. That means easier access into cottage, that means with lower marks, and easier job opportunities. There are certain reservations for backward class.
In order to uplift the poorer sections of the community, should it be reclassified as a backward class in order to receive benefits?
We have, in spite of periods of discrimination and so forth, been very much a forward class. We have been among the leaders of India. In the officer cadres, we have led thousands of others. And my objection, the backward class, as I've said, is an expression of degradation. In a caste-ridden society, to refer to a whole community where we have sections of people who are in the top echelons of achievement, educationally, militarily, and otherwise, to brand our people as backward classes would mean to identify them with the untouchables of India.
Regarded as the pillars of British imperialism, brought deliberately into existence by the British in order to support their growing empire. And we were not just a half-caste community born outside of wedlock. The British subsidized the marriages of their soldiers and their officers with Indian women. That is how we came in. And then you got a community whom the British relied on very heavily for well over 100 years to serve their imperial interests, which we did. Normally, we should have been chased out of India with the British. But I put it down to my leadership that I was able to get the leaders of India to accept us. Not only accept us, but give us a special position in the Indian Constitution.
For 20 years, I am the senior-most member of the Lok Sabha, that's the House of the People. I'm more a nationalist than 99.9% because the average politician is completely regionally, communally oriented. Their whole thinking is parochial. There are, I think, 3,000 different castes and subcastes of Hindus, and each person is thinking in terms of a caste or subcaste. Not in the Anglo-Indian community. We are all Indian in outlook because of my leadership.
Frank Anthony, although not a member of the ruling Congress party, has often been identified as a keen supporter of Mrs. Gandhi. He even supported her actions when, as Prime Minister in 1975, she took a series of tough and highly unpopular measures, claiming they were necessary to safeguard national security.
I did support the emergency. And I made one of the strongest speeches of the House supporting it. The call by Jai Prakash for revolution, calling on the army and the police to mutiny, it was the only thing that was left to Mrs. Gandhi in order to bring stability back to this country.
As a direct result of her controversial actions, Mrs. Gandhi's party lost at the polls, and she was later charged with political misconduct. Frank Anthony was one of those who came to her aid.
She asked me, and I was very glad to defend her, because apart from my own position as a front rank lawyer on the criminal law side, I had no political qualms either. I had been continuously in the center. I am the president in chief of the All India Anglo-Indian Association. The Congress had always recognized this organization. It celebrated its centenary in October 76, which Mrs. Gandhi addressed and paid high but legitimate tribute to the Anglo-Indian community as having made a contribution out of all proportion to their size, that we were pioneers in aviation, forestry, railways, sporting. Our nurses were among the best in the world. She said all that.
What sort of opportunities are available to Anglo-Indians in independent India today?
Well, get right to the top.
How?
No, well, we got to the top, you get to the top. I've got to the top of my profession. I don't know whether any other Anglo-Indian will get there, but at least there's not the remotest suggestion, any kind prejudice against me as an Anglo-Indian. People cut their way through the jungles to come to engage me. I'm talking about especially in murder cases. I was offered a Supreme Court judgeship in 1958 that I declined. I was offered the governorship of the Punjab in 67 that I declined. August before last, Mrs. Gandhi sounded me for the vice presidentship of India, which I declined. Now, can you imagine the British ever having done that? We've had Anglo-Indian admirals in charge of the Navy. At present, we have got LaFontaine in charge of the Air Force.
And all over the country, you have, in this microscopic community, Anglo-Indians in crucial key positions.
The Anglo-Indians have done well in the defense services. We've had a chief of the naval staff who is an Anglo-Indian. And presently today, we have a chief of the air staff who is an Anglo-Indian. And in the largest defense public undertaking, which is Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, you have a chairman who's an Anglo-Indian. And I happen to be that chairman. In the Indian Air Force, initially, we were not allowed to join as officers and as pilots. This embargo seemed to have been lifted somewhere around about 1944. So a large number of Anglo-Indians were able to join the Indian Air Force. And in 1947, when there was the first conflict with Pakistan, approximately 50% of the people undertaking operational missions there were boys from my community. And this is also reflected in the gallantry awards that took place at the end of this conflict. No less than one-third of those gallantry awards went to boys who were Anglo-Indians. I would say any air force has a certain amount of glamour attached to it. The sound, the spectacle, the beauty of aircraft in flight. There's also a certain amount of risk. These were some of the things that appealed to the boys in my community, and they preferred to join the Indian Air Force rather than the Army and the Navy. There was a time, barely 3 or 4 years ago, when out of 14 air marshals, 5 of them were Anglo-Indians. So it is not unnatural for people to say that a large number of Anglo-Indians joined the Air Force and did well, totally out of all proportion to the numbers of Anglo-Indians that were in the country. In the 1960s, a large number of Anglo-Indian families migrated, and it was the more qualified ones that migrated. And it was these more qualified ones who used to join the service. From about 22% of the flying branch in the year of 1962, today it is just a shade over 2%.
The community was 100% employed in the British Airways because there was always some guarantee of employment. And the Anglo-Indian did not have to study because he was automatically recruited onto the railways. I should say that we were pampered by the British. We were instilled with these mottos of loyalty, obedience, and discipline.
Important trains were manned by us. You never had anybody else but the Anglo-Indians manning the mails, expresses, and all the important specials like governors, viceroy special. It was tough. The pay was not very good, though. And work was very hard. But we had a lot of facilities. Colonies were nicely maintained. We had our railway institute where we were only ones allowed to come there, nobody else, and schools. We had cooperative stores where we can, you know, just sign and get whatever you like and it would be recovered from your salary at the end of the month. Those facilities were there.
Colonies would be centered around the railway station. The houses were large houses, 3 to 4 bedrooms with huge gardens and invariably, most of the senior drivers would have a gardener. They would have 2 to 3 inner servants, plus a cook. Every institute had its field for football, cricket. But the main game that used to be played would be hockey. And these railway colonies were the nursery of hockey talent in the country. The Railway Institute was the hub of social activity, not only for the railway people, but we had the elite of Bangalore, and the socials, they were always packed.
It was a tough time during the British days because our salaries were not very much those days, you know. I started on 27 rupees 8 annas a month. And as the fireman confirmed, we were getting 42 rupees 8 annas. Now, of course, the pay scales are good.
What we have today on the Bangalore division, where there are over 15,000 employees, there's hardly 80 to 100 Anglo-Indians, and most of them are above 45. And what we have now is about the last. In the last 20 years, all we've had is just 3 or 4 recruits. So in another 10 years' time, in Bangalore division itself, all we'll have is about a dozen Anglo-Indians and nothing more.
The beautiful South Indian city of Bangalore, described in guidebooks as the Garden City of India, represents modern India at its best. But like every other modern city, it has another side that the tourist rarely sees.
Lingrajapuram could be described as a slum area. It is in a very depressed state. We are outside the limits of Bangalore. And because we're outside, we don't get any of the basic civic amenities. You see, there's no water, there is no sewage system. We have to buy our water from across the lines, particularly drinking water. And, you know, the housing is very poor in many places. People just crowd into one room. And there's a common toilet for about 6 families, and many times there's no toilet at all, so people have to use the streets. The electricity is there, but we tend to get far more power cuts than the rest of Bangalore. I think it's easier to cut us off than maybe where the ministers live. Generally speaking, the Anglo-Indian who tends to live in Lingrajapuram comes from places outside Bangalore. They've come into Bangalore mainly because they've lost their employment, they've retired members of the railway. The gold mines which closed down just outside Bangalore brought quite a few of the Anglo-Indians to live here. And Lingrajapuram has been a haven in some ways for the Anglo-Indian because it's cheaper, housing is cheaper, and there are more Anglo-Indians, and that tends to give them security to go to a place where they could be, just be their own selves. I am an Anglo-Indian, and till I married, I used to wear a dress. But after marriage, I felt that if I am going to make any contribution to the community we are going to live in, that I would wear a sari. And once I started wearing a sari, I didn't want to wear a dress again. But I think the Anglo-Indian-ness part of me is still very much evident. Hello, David. How is everything with you?
Okay, it's over.
Have you been able to find some work?
I'm trying still.
What about your wife?
She's there at home now. She
has she had to go back to her old business again then, or yeah. What is she doing?
Now again she's doing the same thing.
Oh, I'm sorry, David. And how are you doing?
I'm fine. By trade I'm a spray painter. But
have you been able to find anything yet?
No, not yet.
You know, you should try the garages where you could do some spray painting.
I try, but I don't get permanently. I just get for 1 week and then after that I don't get it.
Why don't you come back to the office sometime and then we'll see about it. Okay then, bye. Bye. To understand something of the roles of the men, one has to go back in history to the British Empire, where the Anglo-Indian man never really found a place. He was neither Indian nor British. And because of that, has been, for three or four generations, suppressed. In many ways, you see him just being given roles, secondary roles, really, in the railways, in the police, the PNT, army. But he never really reached the top at all. And that then has found its way right down into our age today.
How has it become worse?
It has become worse because the support of the British, who understood a little bit of him, has been removed. The Indian doesn't quite know how to relate to him. And so he has gone maybe further and further down in his own understanding of himself. And so in a family situation, he is the weaker partner. If he gets unemployed, he stays unemployed. This then makes them feel so worthless that they go off into an escapism. They get involved in alcohol, drugs, because he has no other way, because he comes home to a one room with about seven children, because family planning is not practiced so much because of the strong Roman Catholic community here. And so he comes there, he finds all these problems. What else does he have? He's got no work. So he gets off to the liquor shop, and that's how he escapes. And even sending their own wives. You just become a pimp for their own wives and send them out. She's got to pick up the pieces. After all, they have to eat. There's no sort of security system or anything here, you know, where they could get from the government. So she's got to really look after the family.
I'm Christopher, and this is my aunt Poppy, my mom's sister. And she lives, the next lane to where I live at the moment with my mother's aunt. And I've had a very bad childhood, and I mean, because I don't know my father. He just was, I only heard a few things about him from my mother and friends. And I was very young, my mother married again to a Hindu, and he didn't want me in the home, and he asked me to leave and chase me out, and so I was left in the streets and things like that. I was very, very young when I met a couple of cabaret artists who trained me to become a cabaret dancer, and which later on led into homosexual prostitution, and I led that life for about 7 years and suffered hell. I mean, I've suffered very much, and I look back on the time when my mother used to tell me about things, how she used to be a prostitute, and she suffered the same thing the way I did. But being a cabaret artist, there are so many other cabaret artists too, and prostitutes who I come across when I was in the brothel. I was forced into one, and it was very, very hard. It was terrible. There were girls who were even coming there, who were being sold, you know, for the flesh trade. Young girls, 10, 12, young boys. And there are a lot of Arabs down in Bombay, so it's easier. And there was no other way. I mean, I had to live. I was very young, and everyone took advantage of me. I was used all my life, and I felt this was the easy way of going, so I continued doing it. And even being an artist, some hotels you have to go out with the customers, otherwise they don't give you a contract. So I went, and sometimes my cousin accompanied me, who committed suicide in 83, which is the same problems I've been facing. I mean, he couldn't take it anymore, so he too was a homosexual prostitute, but not a cabaret artist.
How did you end up becoming a prostitute?
I ended up because my mother had no one to look after her, and I was the eldest in the family. So just to help my mother to support the other younger ones, I had to go into that line. But it wasn't for very long, and I wasn't very happy with it. And then when I became a cabaret artist also, Paula, I faced a lot of problems because of my not being very friendly with the men. So I was not appreciated. And I gave that up after a short time. Say about 2 years I was a cabaret artist.
Tell me about your domestic life with your husband.
I had a very hard life. Ronnie used to drink and beat me up. And of course, my daughter had to be given over to my mother to be put in a school. And I faced a lot of problems with Ronnie, selling everything in the house. So I left him completely, and now I'm staying with Tommy.
Your boy seemed to be quite sober today. Tommy, I've just come back from out. Is that okay?
Okay.
And I've sold some things.
And didn't get some job.
I've got some job for pussy. And Tommy also is a man who drinks. And to be very frank with you, I'm not very happy. And he's quite rude to me when he's drunk. What's the matter? Shall we go on?
Yeah.
I live now with my mother's aunt, who's very poor. And I've tried the jobs everywhere, and no one seems to give me a job. If you say a Christopher Bastian, say an Anglo-Indian, if you speak Kannada, I can't. No job, forget it. And many Christian organizations don't want to help me because they say, your people tell us that you're gay, because it's not very much accepted in India. They just tell me you have to be born again, you have to believe in God, and then only we'll help you. We see you coming to church, we'll help you. I mean, I just can't go there being a hypocrite. But I love India, I mean, because I've been all my life in India. And I don't know if the government is aware of what's going on. I mean, because no organization, no Anglo-Indian association, nothing, nobody comes forward to do. It's just when they want your votes for elections, they come begging you, giving you a loaf of bread or giving you a set of clothing. And after that, their promises are gone because we are poor. They treat us like inferior people.
And I feel the same as Christopher, that nobody has any love or feelings towards us. In other words, we are not destitute actually, but I can't tell you.
Isolated.
What. Yeah, from everybody. The Anglo-Indian Association promises us everything and gives us nothing.
I've made a change in life and I'm trying to keep up to it, but the pressures and the temptations are just too much. I can't, and sometimes I feel of going back to prostitution or to become a cabaret artist. At least I have my necessities. I mean, how long could you go around asking people for help and get insults, and sometimes they're so rude, you know? I mean, we've had just too much of them that they've literally broken me up to pieces, the people, the associations, the Christians. I really can't take it anymore. I'm just looking for a break, and I need a break, but nobody does anything. I've suffered along with my aunt, we've suffered all of my life. I just need someone to do something for me, but still, there's nothing working out. I think I merely have land up to being a prostitute again, or being a cabaret artist. Even that's very dangerous. I mean, it's not hard when the customers come burning you with cigarettes and mauling you around, and you're just picked up by people on the street just because you're a prostitute and raped and thrown around. You go to the Christian people and tell them that I've had police problem because I've been raped, but the case is turned over me, but they do nothing. They just tell you, we're not going to help you. Go to one of your clients. Who go to you. I mean, this is the way the Christian people talk to us. I'm so fed up, I'm so disgusted of life, I may even end up committing suicide.
The final of the Olympic hockey. The wonderful Indian team in the white shorts, who so far have scored 30 goals to naught in the tournament, are playing Germany.
The British government, the Raj, was very keen on good teams.
India score.
I can just give you one example, which is typical of what used to go on in those days. There was a gentleman called Mr. Fraser, who was chief local manager of the Ajmer workshops. And he told the Anglo-Indian community, you don't need to pass any exams. You don't need to drive a train. You don't need to snip a ticket, provided you play good hockey. And he was able to put seven people from the BBNCI workshop in Ajmer into the Olympic team.
India score again.
1932, 1936, the British encouraged them to be excellent sportsmen, and they were excellent sportsmen. Now that opportunity seems to have passed them by since independence. And if you look around today, well, I see a lot of this stadium, and I know who's running around it and who's jumping. I never see an Anglo-Indian in the sports field at all.
They're not coming forward to participate nowadays. Community as such is not very interested in sport. Probably because they're not encouraged. Perhaps they don't have the means to participate. And they haven't been given many opportunities at school and national level. In the 30s and 40s, we had a lot of Anglo-Indians. And between 1932 and 56 at the Olympic Games, we had won 7 gold medals, actually.
In line with the heel of your left foot. The other thing. Same thing, all of you.
They had no difficulty because they were encouraged to participate in sports, and through sports they were given fairly decent jobs.
I was shocked when I was at the Tokyo Olympics to find 5 Anglo-Indian boys from a little place like Bandiqui in Rajasthan, who had made the grade for the Olympic hockey team and had played for some years, 5 Pierce brothers. So, and this is not the end of it. For many years after that, they carried their know-how, they carried their expertise to Australia, and Australia is probably one of the best teams in the world today, entirely due to the fact that they were taught the classic hockey by Anglo-Indians who had emigrated. Today in India, if you want to do well, I suppose all over the world it's the same thing, you have to be qualified. And education of the Anglo-Indian community was neglected for so many years before because their main forte was games. And when the British left, those that were left behind, the residue, were not very well educated. Later on, they never got the opportunity to educate themselves because they couldn't afford it. And so they got left behind.
My task when I actually took over as Secretary of the Interstate Board for Anglo-Indian Education in 1948 was to reorient the pattern of education, because Anglo-Indian education was based on what was being done in Britain. Now, I as a child and people of my vintage learned Durham, Durham on the Weir, Newcastle, Newcastle on the Tyne, London, London on the Thames. And so we went down the east coast and up the west coast, learning in the main towns. We hardly knew anything about Indian geography. In history, we learnt about Alfred not being a good cook and burning the cakes, about King Bruce of Scotland throwing himself down and being entertained by a spider. Canute had some phobia about not having his feet washed even by the sea waves. All these things which are not relevant. We didn't learn Indian history as such.
So what was your task?
My task was to introduce Indian history, Indian geography, lay stress apart on Indian languages, apart from English, because we believe that English is an Indian language because it is the mother tongue of an Indian minority, the Anglo-Indian community.
Hey, Majesty, the king and queen.
Therefore, we set out to preserve our culture, the basis of which is our English language.
Has Crown Baron arrived yet?
No, Your Majesty, but he has sent a message which I have been waiting for your arrival. It is with great sorrow
that we are constantly being faced with threats which go to the very heart of the existence of the community. English language.
And difficulties of searching. Mine meant...
I was able to get from Nehru on my own in Parliament the Nehru formula making English the associate official language of the Union of India. I fought the whole Hindi bloc alone. English would have disappeared because 100,000 Anglo-Indians can't keep English alive. Today it is the, to my mind, the Nehru formula has saved the integrity of India. It is the only real linked language between the North and the South. More Indians, my estimate is today it's about 40 million, 5 or 10 years ago it was 30 million, more Indians study through the medium of English from the nursery to the university stage.
Anglo-Indian schools, of which there are now 300 in the country, were getting special grants. No other schools in the country received these special grants. When the Constitution of India was on the anvil, Article 337 was built into it, at the instance of Mr. Anthony, that the special grants would continue in order to give the Anglo-Indian schools an opportunity to adjust themselves to the new India. But the condition was that we had to make admissions of at least 40% of members of communities other than the Anglo-Indian community. Now, the very fact that these schools were and are still some of the leading schools in the country, there was immediately a tremendous demand for admissions. And I know schools which only had 90 pupils in them. And in the course of a few years, the pupils went up to 1,000. And today, there are hundreds of thousands of non-Anglo-Indians who are sharing in our culture and who are promoting our culture, so that we are looked upon as the purveyors of a new type of culture, which is really an international culture, which the country requires.
I would say most of these schools cater for Indians, not Anglo-Indians, because they're quite expensive. All schools in India are today. And a few scholarships here and there would not give numerous opportunities to permit this community to lift itself up by the bootstraps.
The reason for our community having some of the best educational institutions while not benefiting from these institutions is because our problem is largely economic. Even if you have a school, you can't go to school on a hungry stomach. You can't possibly go to school when you have other children in the home to look after. And if one remembers that 40% of our community lives below what is called the subsistence level, the problem is of tremendous proportions, economically.
You can spend money on providing a meal or providing clothes or providing any other facility. But if a child has a good education, then you have provided, I think, the most vital basic need which will help the child forward in life. And this is what we have been concentrating on since I have been one of the leaders of the community.
The Frank Anthony schools are par excellence Anglo-Indian because in the constitutional sense they've been founded by us, Anglo-Indians, administered by us. I keep a majority of teachers as Anglo-Indians. We never discriminate in our schools against anybody, whether he's a Sikh, he's a Muslim, he's an Indian Christian, anybody. That's why they come to our schools. The scholarships, I have a regular formula. Any Anglo-Indian family getting up to 500 rupees a month, I give complete free ships. up to 750, they pay the one-fifth of the fee. Up to 1,500 a month, they pay two-fifths of the fee.
Now, the scale of these scholarships are being criticized for being too minimal in this day and age.
You see, the people who would criticize would be people who haven't got the remotest part of a little finger of contribution to the community. We have to apportion our resources. I'm building. I spent lakhs on building. Our teachers are among the best paid in the country, otherwise we won't get Anglo-Indians. And the community benefits in the sense, now you take the trust that I'm building, because the margins I get are plowed back to the community.
There was a time when the leadership of the Anglo-Indian Association and the leadership of the community under Mr. Frank Anthony was looked up to by a lot of people all around the country. And I think we need to pay tribute to Mr. Anthony for the role he played immediately after independence. But I think, as someone said not so long ago, there is a need for a changing of the guard. There is a need for people who have come from the masses, who know the problems of the people, who have gone down right to the homes that are in these economic straits, who are approachable and available, and who have a vision to lead this community to where it ought to be in India. And I think perhaps, with all due respect to our leaders, some of them are on the wrong side of 70, to say the least.
The leadership of the community is in touch, because so far as I'm concerned, I've got about 70 branches.
Today is what, 17?
On an average, I get 20 or 30 letters a day from my office bearers. Every major problem comes to me. Nobody else has the capacity or the stature to deal with them.
You haven't seen this, have you?
No, I haven't seen this.
Quite obviously, the leadership at the top must be concerned with policy matters which will affect the whole community. Our local branches are the ones that collect funds and they meet the needs of the local people.
I've written an editorial. I've entitled it, Karnataka Declares War on English and the Minorities.
And other people have said that perhaps it's time for the two senior MPs to step down and allow someone else to take up the reins.
Yes, I suppose people will have their opinions on this. If they want to step into the shoes of somebody else, they will want the shoes removed and they'll put their feet into it.
I was a member of the Anglo-Indian Association in 1967. But for some reasons, I, together with a team of others, was axed from that association.
What sort of role did you play at that time?
I was president of the community here and of the branch of that All India Anglo-Indian Association, and in that particular role we had introduced a number of innovative measures which led to some amount of disgruntlement with the powers that were at the time, and as a consequence we had to go the way of all flesh.
The only time I've expelled people is when I've found them basically not disloyal, but basically destructive of unity in the country.
Well, I was the vice president of this association from 75 to 79, and well, my only difference of opinion with them was that since they had so much money at their disposal, well, I'm told a couple of crores of rupees, which is a lot of money, and I felt they ought to share this with the poor Anglo-Indians, particularly those who are not members of the All India Anglo-Indian Association. But this was stipulated that he or she must be a member of the association to derive any benefits from the association. Well, I persisted. In fact, I was in New Delhi. I saw Mr. Anthony there. We had a chat over a cup of tea, and we parted as friends. Well, he did ask me to consider my, my plans of leaving. Well, I came back and I decided to leave.
Why are there so many breakaway organizations and groups from the association?
Many breakaways. You get an odd nondescript whom we expel, like in this day. Then you get another nondescript with 52 members, as in Madras. There are no breakaway organizations. They're not organized.
We can't afford pathways. We can't afford to have mushroom bodies. But if Mr. Anthony could see in our line of thinking and, part with some more money for the poor Anglo-Indians, I don't believe there would be any necessity of having another organization. Though this is an all-India body, the one that you just now referred to, while ours is just a very small organization covering the entire Bangalore. But like me, maybe there'll be several other organizations in the country, but I still believe that we ought to get together sometime or the other. And I think the only thing we can do is maybe after somebody takes over from Mr. Anthony, the younger ones.
Now, some people would go so far as to say that you betrayed the trust vested in you and are now just content with personal prestige.
I mean, that would be a viciously false statement. I couldn't get personal prestige if I didn't have the capacity to advance the interests of the community. And the personal prestige I have achieved has been in the face of the bitterest of controversies.
Whilst I do agree that Mr. Anthony and Mr. Barrow might be well on in years, let us be very honest with ourselves. Today, I have my personal doubts whether there is anybody who could match them as leaders of the community at the center. They're well seasoned, they know what the problems are that face the community, and unfortunately, we have been a community that has depended too much on somebody else. And with the independence of the country, we were caught with our backs against the wall. We have the capacity, we have the educational background, but we just don't have the will to really do something for ourselves.
Studies are concerned, not many Anglo-Indian children have the chance to study higher, like management or law or anything, like me. There is the lack of financial assistance for most Anglo-Indians, and we have to take bank loans. Like me, I had to take a study loan to finish my Bachelor of Commerce degree, and I plan to do a higher management degree in the University of Sydney.
Well, at the moment, I'm doing my pre-university course, my second year at Jyothi Nivas Girls College, and I'm doing my commerce. I plan to do a degree, but I mean, it depends on many things. Actually, I'd like to take singing as my profession. But in India, I don't think there's much scope. I mean, we're not exactly given the chance, you know? We're not given the break. Although I love singing. And I've been doing many concerts and shows and stuff like that.
Well, I've been one of the lucky few who have been able to go through a thorough education right up to high school, and also been able to go through a lot of educational courses, after which I was asked to give up education because Daddy wanted me to pursue my career in hockey. Well, I did manage to get to the top, that is, play for India. Though, of course, I had to undergo a lot of difficulties and hardships on the way, mainly because I was an Anglo-Indian, and I couldn't communicate with our Indian language, which is very, very important.
Well, most of us Anglo-Indians feel that our future doesn't lie in India, because there are a few barriers. For example, the language problem we have. In Bangalore, they've begun to make Kannada the first language. And it's quite a barrier for us because most of us speak English. And we've also learned Hindi as the national language in school.
But not Kannada.
But not Kannada. And now all of a sudden they want us to switch over to Kannada, which is quite impossible.
For instance, today, unless you have a minimum of an SSLC, which is a secondary school leaving certificate, you cannot even go in or to a school as a teacher's help, that's even with a kindergarten class. That's the minimum. Now what happens, our children, of course there are many reasons. One may be financial, which is the main one I should say, and the other this attitude of why should I learn a foreign language? Why should I learn Hindi? Why should I learn Tamil? Why should I learn Kannada? Whereas, as I say, before we learnt Latin, we learnt Urdu, we learnt Hindi, we learnt it as youngsters, and we passed. But this is a wrong attitude that we have.
As far as I've seen, many of my friends, Anglo-Indian friends, they have problems with the language, and some of them have even left the country because of that. I mean, solely because of that.
Yeah, I think language is a very important factor, and if you learn it, half the problems are over. It's very important in the environment you live in, I feel. Fortunately, we have been living in a very, you know, with all Bengalis and Punjabis and a lot of other Indians living around us. So we have mixed with them. We have learned the language. We are very much like them. And I feel if more Anglo-Indians move into areas like that, I think it would be better for the community rather than just stick together in a couple of areas like it is in the city today.
You come from a professional family and you're both graduates. Are you aware of any discrimination because of the Anglo-Indian tag?
No, I think this is something that we always use as an excuse more than anything else. If you do your best, I don't think there'll be any barriers. It always happens when a person can't, an Anglo-Indian cannot do something, then it makes it as an excuse saying that, you know, we are discriminated because we're Anglo-Indian, because we're neither Indian nor British or anything like that. But I think you have to make the best of what there is, that's all. And I think that people say that when they migrate to Australia and other places, they are going to do well there. But actually what's happening is they're going there and they are working hard and they're doing everything that's needed to do well, but they aren't doing it here. It's obviously, that's the reason. I mean, if you do the same thing here, you're going to get the results. But they're not doing that. And they say, you know, we've got better chances abroad.
Andy, would you consider emigrating?
I would like to stay in this country because I'm used to it. I've been abroad, I've been to Europe, I've seen Europe. It's a nice place for holiday, but I don't think it's more than that. We might not work that hard occasionally, but I think there's a lot of depth. There's a lot more to look forward to than just material things, which I feel that people in other countries are more interested in.
Ladies and gentlemen, for you, the Apaches will perform Green Dough.
I decided not to emigrate because I was very well off in the country as far as my job was concerned, the comforts and everything connected with it. At that particular time, I didn't really give much thought to my two daughters' future. And now that the years have passed, this is really one of the main causes that worries both Olivia and I, not so much for ourselves, but for the future of our daughters. Because let me make it very clear, this is without casting any aspersions whatsoever to the non-Anglo-Indians who would be prepared to marry our girls, but their whole background, their culture, whether they're educated or not, is very, very different to the culture in which we have been brought up. For instance, a simple thing, when a girl gets married, she literally loses her identity as far as the in-laws are concerned. They won't be able to talk freely amongst men. The moment they go to their in-laws' house, their place is literally in the kitchen. They're not even seen. Now, our girls have never been brought up to that.
it's very important that we try and marry an Anglo-Indian for the simple reason it becomes much easier because you've been, even if you're not from the same, the same economic background or whatever, but you are definitely, you are eating the same things, you are socializing in the same place. So it is important that we try and marry within, but there is no problem, I feel, if you marry out, but it just becomes more difficult. There are more complications.
Depends on the girl. If I love the girl, I'll marry out. That's no hassle about that. And my parents wouldn't mind, though they would like me to marry in my community.
Actually, the Anglo-Indian boys in India, quite a few of them are quite lazy. They'd rather drop out of school. And they have to realize that, there's no chance without completing their education and then taking up a real good job.
So how's that going to affect your marriage prospects?
Well, you see, we look for boys who have good prospects, who have a stable job and a good salary or something.
Would you consider marrying non-Anglo-Indians?
Yeah. In India, it's definitely...
Yeah, because most of the Anglo-Indian boys here, nobody think of actually having a married life with them and stuff.
Ladies and gentlemen, give these 15 beautiful girls a lovely hand, please.
Where the finance is concerned, it's extremely difficult for the boy, mainly because we girls are the breadwinner in the family. Our boys have not had the facilities, financial mainly, to go through a thorough education, which is really a stumbling block for them because they can't get very good jobs.
Where do you feel your future to lie?
Well, definitely not in India. There's nothing left for us out here. They're trying to trample upon us, mainly because we are basically not Indian.
A few short months ago, students all over Britain were preparing for their end-of-year exams, but it was also a time of reckoning for university administrators deciding...